I said, I think I've been sneezing since I got here. Amen. I'm going to have to pray myself well. Amen. But I know when people hear you, they assume they know what you look like. And then when they see you, they kind of go, is that him? Is that really him? It's me. And it just gets worse from here on out because I'm going to undo my neckties. I'm probably going to get juicy. You folk on the front row sit there at your own risk. Amen. I get juicy, but it's a good juicy. Amen. Let me see the hand of every person that's ready for God to do something wonderful in your life tonight. Now lift up your other hand and say, Lord, I'm ready. I'm ready right now. In Jesus' name. Then put your hands together. Sharing from the word of the Lord, a word that God has placed in my spirit. How many right now are facing something that you don't have the answer for? How many are facing a problem, a situation, circumstances, that if you could have changed them, you already would have? It may be an unsaved spouse. It may be a financial issue. It may be a physical problem. But how many are facing something that only God, oh, touch your neighbor, say, God can. And tonight I believe he will. Now, part of my job as a prophet of God is to help position you strategically for what God is about to do in this service. When you look in the Bible, the great miracles of history usually occurred in the scriptures when three things happened. People were in the right place at the right time doing the right thing. Now, in baseball, two out of three get you in the Hall of Fame. If you get a hit two out of three times, actually, if you strike out two out of three times when you go up to bat, you'll still get in the Hall of Fame because that means you have a lifetime batting average of .333. But with God, two out of three doesn't get a miracle. Because when you look in the Bible, you'll find that there were people who were in the place of the anointing. They were in the right place, and they were there at the time of visitation. But because they weren't doing the right thing. For example, in John 5, there's a man who sat at the pool of Bethesda, had been there 38 years. He was in the place of miracles. Whenever an angel would come and stir up the water, whoever got in first would get healed. When Jesus met the man, he said, do you want to walk? And he said, I've been here 38 years. I don't have an angel troubling the waters. And even if I did, I have no one to put me in. Now, he was in the right place at the right time, but he couldn't do the right thing. I got to tell you, if that would have been me, I'd have had somebody roll me over to the edge. And I'd have slept with my big toe. And at the first sound of an angel wing, I'd just plop. See, you can, just because you're in a service like this, and the anointing of God is present, and people are being healed and blessed, that doesn't mean necessarily that you're going to receive. Somebody said, well, then what am I here for? Well, if you don't participate, if you don't enter in, if you're not willing to make a move to touch the hem of Jesus' garment, hello, you can be around the anointing all you want. See, some people have the idea that if they're around, it's like in our churches, I told the folks on Easter Sunday that just because you have a pastor that's prophetic and we're a church that believes in miracles, that doesn't mean the prophetic or the miraculous is automatically going to happen for you. If you don't enter in, if you don't make a move towards, see, the word says to draw nigh, we need to move first and then he will draw nigh unto us. Somebody say amen. The woman with the issue of blood didn't wait for Jesus to come where she was. She said, if I can get to him, if I can but touch the hem of his garment. Tonight before we minister, I want to give you an opportunity to do something that will position you strategically, the right place, right time, doing the right thing. before I preach, before I pray, before I prophesy, before I do anything else, we're going to praise God in our giving. Because giving is the key to receiving. Okay, the Bible, Paul the Apostle said, Jesus declared, well, actually Luke wrote it in the book of Acts, Jesus said that it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. Now, human nature doesn't agree with that. Human nature would rather receive than give, because to give something means I have to let go of something that's precious to me. But if you understand the kingdom of God, giving, when you and I give, we are reflecting the nature of our Heavenly Father. That's why the Bible said that God loves a cheerful giver, because when we give, we are acting like Him. One of the greatest giving scriptures in the Bible is one that people quote all the time and don't even realize that it has to do with giving. It's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Nobody asked Him. He didn't have to. He gave, because our God is a giver. So tonight, before I preach, before we pray, before we do anything, I'm going to give you an opportunity to position yourself to receive through giving. You can't buy anything from God. You can't pay God for a miracle. You can't pay me for a blessing. Well, Rev, if you give me a word from the Lord, I'll write you a big, fat, juicy check. Well, you just keep your big, fat, juicy check and go to hell. Because that's witchcraft. Well, I'm sorry, but I only got one night. Now, I will not prostitute the gift of God. I've been preaching 40 years. There's no amount of money that's worth losing my soul. I'm not going to start in Sumter, South Carolina. The reason that I challenge people to give is because I know the key to receiving is giving. Look in the Bible. Nearly every miracle that happened in some way was connected to giving. In 1 Kings, the 17th chapter, a widow woman gave a prophet a pancake. And what did she get in return? Unlimited supply, right? In the book of Genesis, Abraham offered his son Isaac as a sacrifice, gave him to God. And what did God do? God revealed Himself as Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. Now, I understand human nature. As I said, I've been preaching 40 years. I went to college. I learned psychology and a lot of other things. If it was about money, the smart thing to do would be to pray for people, shout with them for a while, hoot with them for a while, get them blessed, and then ask them to give. But you see, that's not faith. Faith says, before I ever see it, before I ever possess it, before it ever happens, I'm going to worship God like it's already done. That's what God is looking for, and those are the kind of folks that are positioned to receive. So tonight, I'm going to invite now. I understand if I pray for somebody. I forget where we were just at. Where were we? Chicago? A man had been blind. I don't remember how long. Long time. Man had been blind. We laid hands on him and prayed, and God opened his eyes. And I don't have to tell you, in Chicago there were about probably 10 times as many people, but they went crazy. Or as they say, cray cray. I mean, there were folk knocking one another over, shouting. They were knocking chairs over. And this man, I'm sure it had been at least 10 years. All of a sudden he could see, and he started acting like he was a boxer. He started going like this. God, he said, I can see, and people went crazy. Now, if it was about just excitability, that would have been the time to receive the offering. Somebody say amen. But see, that's not faith. See, people believe when they can see something, but Jesus said to Thomas, you have believed because you have seen, but blessed are they who have not seen. Oh, no, nobody with me tonight in South Carolina. I guess all the safe folk are over in Augusta. Hallelujah. Or Columbia. No. I'm want to give you an opportunity to put a seed in the ground, because as the anointing goes forth and waters this service, I prophesy that some of you right here will begin to reap a harvest before this service is over. I didn't say by tomorrow, I didn't say a week from now, I said before this night is over. Now, I also believe in practicing what I preach. I believe in giving. Every one of you tonight that will sow a seed of $20 or more to help us. Number one, we're going to pay the expenses. It costs money to rent an auditorium, to rent equipment, to do all of the things to make a service like this happen. Every dollar you give, number one, we'll use it to pay for the service. Any money that's left over, we will use it to pay the bill to stay on the air here in your area. So every dollar will stay in this area to touch people, amen, with the gospel. Everyone that gives a seed of 20 or more, I'm going to bless you with a brand new series. This has only been out 2 months, I think. It's called Take the Battle to the Enemy. You know, we talk about the whole armor of God, but Bishop, most people, when they talk about the whole armor of God, talk about the helmet of salvation, breastplate of righteousness, shield of faith, loins girt about with truth, feet shod with the preparation of the gospel. None of that is offensive. All of that is defensive. It's to protect you. But God has given us weapons by which we can take authority over the enemy. Put him on the run. Put him under your feet. Somebody say amen. And too many Christians have become a doormat for the devil. Well, if I could just hold on and hang out. Jesus didn't come just so you could hang on and hold out, and in the meantime, be a punching bag for the booger man. Jesus said, I am come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly. That means to be the head and not the tail. It means to be blessed and not cursed, prospered and not broke. Somebody say amen. This series, I'll give you about 9 or 10 different offensive weapons to use as a believer, right from the scripture, how to put the devil on the run, how to get him out of your house, how to get him off your loved ones, how to get him out of your pocketbook. How many know the devourer comes to steal, kill, and destroy the devil? This is a 3-hour series. You can either have it on 3 CDs or 3 cassette tapes. My wife and I are going to send this to you as a token of our love and appreciation for your help with a gift of $20 or more. We don't have a huge crowd tonight, so some of you could maybe do more than 20. Maybe you could give 40 or 50 or 100. The budget for tonight's service is about $3,100, $3,200. God may lay it on your heart to give $500 or $1,000. Every dollar will help us. Anything that comes in above what we need for the budget, we'll use it to stay on 98.3. We've also added Florence. Any folks from Florence tonight? They let you out. Praise God. Thank you for coming over. Amen. And do we have any from Columbia? Thank you for coming over. God bless you. Oh, that's a good little ride. Thank you for making the trip. Pastor is on. Thank you. And I know we've got some from Orange. Right? I know we've got Bishop and Sister you. Oh, there you are. Thank you for coming. I know that's a good little trip too. Thank you so much. I'm honored. Amen. I want to bless you with this. It'll help us pay for the service, help us stay on the air, preaching the gospel and ministering by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here's what we're going to do. In a moment, we're going to pray, and after we pray, the ushers are going to walk up and down the aisles with these little gold envelopes. And if you would like to sow a seed of 20 or more and receive the series, hold up your hand after we pray.